Nathan?
Oh, okay. I see it now. Oh, okay. I see his evidence. I was about to get a little nervous. Good morning, Sunday School.
Good morning.
Before we get started, I need some readers for today. Hands.
Okay.
How many?
Oh,
about three.
Oh, I can see.
So you can find that scripture and have it ready for me?
Oh, okay.
Okay, we are still studying obedience. All this quarter, we've studied obedience. So let us have a word of prayer before we get started. Our Father, we come to you this morning with bowed heads and humble and thankful hearts. Lord, we thank you for all the blessings that you have bestowed upon us. And we thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you for another opportunity to assemble together in this place to study your word. We ask that you would send your Holy Spirit to lead us through this lesson and guide us and keep us focused, Lord, with understanding. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Today's lesson title, Obedience in Offerings. Our lesson text, Leviticus chapter 22, verses 17 through 26 and 31 through 33. Our lesson outline, the command regarding offerings. Leviticus chapter 22, verses 17 through 19, restrictions on offerings. Leviticus 22, verses 20 through 25, and the principle behind acceptable offerings. Leviticus chapter 22, verses 31 through 33. Now, before we go on, let's do a couple of definitions. Is that on the next slide? Obedience. The first definition I took from Pastor Jackson. I thought it was a very good definition and easy, simple and easy to understand. Obedience, the willingness to obey, to be in compliance with order, request, or law, or to submit to another's authority. And does anyone else have anything else to add to that? Definition for obedience. Okay, definition for offering, the giving of something as an act of worship or devotion, a contribution or a gift as to a church for some special purpose. Okay, would you like to offer something? Would you like to add something to that? No? Okay, that's enough? Okay. All right, today's aim, the facts to see the instructions for giving and the purpose, the principles behind those instructions. The principle, to show that when we comply with God's instructions and express principles, we are obeying Him and acknowledging Him as our God. The application, to arrange our thinking and actions so that when we do give, we will do it as God instructed and not as we think best. Okay, introduction. Now, I took this introduction from our Sunday School book. I thought it was befitting for this our society today. It says, charities to help the poor are very common in today's society. We sometimes receive appeals for certain items, but there are limits to what they will take. They don't want junk, such as clothing with holes or patches, appliances that no longer work are unacceptable, as are broken lamps, dresses, etc. These kind of items insult the poor, and it's supposed to help them. So can you name some other items that are requested by charity? Right, other kind of furniture. What's the main thing they're asking for now? Money. Money, that's right. They ask for money. I mean, you see all kinds of advertising on television, even for animals. Yeah, elephants, cats, dogs, yeah. You know, yeah. If there are limits concerning the gifts we give to other human beings, how much more are the restrictions concerning what we give to God? So when we give to the poor, we're giving to God. So do we give grudgingly, out of necessity? Mm-hmm. Or do we give with a cheerful heart? Does someone have 2 Corinthians 9, 6, and 7? Okay, are you ready?
You. 2 Corinthians 9, 6, and 7. But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he that soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or out of necessity. For God loveth a cheerful giver.
Okay. We hear that every Sunday, don't we? Right. During the offertory statement. Give with a cheerful heart. If you're going to give it grudgingly, you might as well keep it. Okay, Scripture makes it clear that only the best is pleasing to God. He's not satisfied with leftovers. Now, that reminded me of Genesis 4. With Cain and Abel. Remember, Cain gave some of the fruits of the soil, and Abel gave fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. And God accepted whose offer? He accepted Abel's. He didn't accept Cain's offer. So what do you think was going on with Cain's offer? It could have been. Any other thoughts on that?
He really didn't want to give it.
He didn't want to give it? Okay, so he gave it grudgingly? Okay. Other thoughts? Okay, God accepted Abel's sacrifice, like we said, but he rejected Cain.
Let me ask you a question.
Yes.
That has always puzzled me. Why was his not acceptable, Cain's offering?
Okay. The Bible does not tell us why God rejected Cain's sacrifice. But this is what I found. It says, perhaps his attitude was improper, or perhaps his offering was not up to God's standard. So when we give to God and others, we should have a joyful heart. Yes. Haphazardly, his attitude. Okay, could have been. Like I say, the Bible didn't, I didn't find a reason in the Bible. It wasn't spelled out in Scripture. Ms. Etta, you have something else to add?
No, I said we studied that once before.
We did.
We didn't really know.
Yes.
We studied it once before, and it seems to me it says that it wasn't his best that he was giving. He kept the best for himself. Mm-hmm. And gave what he didn't want.
To God.
To God.
Okay. Any other comments? We can only speculate, right? Okay. Our lesson today examines how God's people are to be obedient in their gifts and offerings to him. So this lesson shows the principles set forth in his commands to Israel. He gave strict rules regarding the offerings they brought. Now today's lesson begins with verse 17 of Leviticus chapter 22. So the first 16 verses deals with rules for the priests. And this week's lesson deals with the sacrificial offerings. Okay, next slide. Okay, we did that. Keep moving. Okay, let's read verse 17 and 18. May I have a reader?
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto Aaron and to his sons and to all the children of Israel, and say unto them, whatsoever he be of the house of Israel or of the strangers in Israel, that will offer his oblation for all his vows and for all his freewill offerings, which they will offer unto the Lord for a burnt offering.
Okay. These regulations were not intended to provide a way of salvation. They were given to a people already redeemed by God. And how were they redeemed? They were redeemed by God's grace and set apart to him. Anybody have Exodus 19, 3 through 6? Okay. Here. Maybe that will tell you.
And Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, you have seen what I had did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings, and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice, and keep my commandments, then ye shall be a special treasure to me above all people, for all the earth is mine, and ye shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words which you shall speak to the children of Israel.
Okay, so how were they redeemed?
By God.
How? His grace.
Yeah.
Okay, but what did God do?
He delivered them from the Egyptians.
Right, that's it. He delivered them. Remember, he brought them out of slavery. Right, that's how he redeemed them, and he set them apart for himself. Now, I found that God had a reason for rescuing the Israelites from slavery, and he was ready to tell them what it was. Israel was to become a kingdom of priests and a holy nation, where anyone could approach God freely. I think Joanne mentioned that in her scripture. A nation of priests.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It didn't take long, though, for the people to corrupt God's plan. And God then established Aaron's descendants from the tribe of Levi as priests, representing what the entire nation should have been. But with the coming of Jesus Christ, God has once again extended his plan to all believers. The death and resurrection of Christ has allowed each of us to approach God freely. Now, why did God even choose Israel as his nation? What did we say? Any thoughts on that?
He needed to be an example.
Okay. He needed an example. Anybody else? Okay, God knew that no nation on earth was good enough to deserve to be called his people. He chose Israel not because of anything they had done, but in his love and mercy, he chose Israel in spite of the wrong the nation had done and would do. Anyway, God is sovereign. He can do what he wants to do, right? Okay, so that was his plan, to choose Israel as his own. Now, why did he want to have a special nation on earth? There were other nations. Why did he want a special nation? Joanne brought it out just a minute ago. She didn't know it. She was getting ahead of me.
An example and reputation.
Okay. He wanted a special nation to represent his way of life, to teach his word, and to be an agent of salvation to the world. All nations would be blessed through Abraham's descendants. Through the nation of Israel, the Messiah would be born. And God chose one nation and put it through a rigorous training program so that one day it could be a channel for blessings to the whole world. Okay, so in verses 17 and 18, who was the Lord speaking to? Who did he speak to? Okay, so that took care of everybody, didn't it? Okay, the Lord's words to Moses were addressed to Aaron and his sons and to all the children of Israel. The regulations to follow were to be obeyed by both the priests who received the offerings and the persons who brought them. It was important that God's command be followed precisely, and nobody could plead ignorance of them. Remember, Moses would always bring everybody together and give them the directions or the commands. So you couldn't say, I didn't know. You know how we do sometimes? Mm-hmm. We don't know something. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there was no reason for them not to know. Furthermore, the rules were to be enforced for offerings brought by both the Israelites themselves and by the foreigners, so joining in Israel. The foreigners were bound by the same regulations as Israelites. The offerings in this passage were part of a category known as peace or fellowship offerings. They were brought by those who, by virtue of prior sacrifice for sin, were at peace with God. These gifts were of three types. Number one, some were offerings of thanksgiving for divine favors. Number two, others were votive offerings related to the completion of a vow. A third type was the free will offering. Now, peace offerings were usually brought spontaneously by private individuals. In the burnt offering, the whole animal was consumed in the fire. In the peace offering, it was not. Instead, the parts left after the fat and inner parts were sacrificed were to be divided between priests and the worshipers, and eaten at a sacrificial meal with the worshipper's family and friends. Now, the three types of peace offerings, our text deals with two: the votive, which is the completion of a vow, and the free will offerings, which is voluntary offering. Now, we do a lot of free will offerings here. Can you think of some in our church? What's a free will offering? Okay, yeah, that's a free will. You give what you desire, and there are some others. Yeah.
When we have the various groups who are asking us to donate, right, that's a free will
offering.
That's
free will. You give what you can, okay? And we just did a free will offering, too, for our anniversary. Remember? The 96? Okay, that was free will. Yeah. Pardon me? Sunday school, right. So we do a lot of free will offerings here. And of course, the sacrificial. Okay, verse 19, the Lord commanded, "Ye shall offer at your own will a male without blemish," which is without any spot or defect, "of the beeves," which are the cattle, "of the sheep," or of the goats. And at your own will implies that the offering is to be freely given, and that's what we just talked about. Okay, what animals were acceptable and why?
Animals without blemish.
Okay. What kind? We just read it. Verse 19. Right. Right.
And it had to be a male.
That was for the peace offering. It could include certain kinds of animals, the cattle, sheep, and goats. These were among those God had designated as clean by Israel that was suitable for eating, and also suitable as offerings to God. And second, the animal had to be a male with no blemishes. Now, I don't know why it couldn't be female. I thought about that. But God was asking for male. Now, why should these animals be physically flawless? They couldn't have a defect.
Yeah.
Use the mic.
God is holy himself, and he didn't want to accept anything that was not holy.
Exactly.
Or without blemishes.
Right.
Or with blemishes, I'm sorry.
With blemishes, right. Okay, number one, they were gifts to a holy God who deserved nothing less than perfection. Number two, physical wholeness was required of any priest who offered sacrifices to the Lord. And we're going to get into that, too, about the priests in a few minutes. And number three, both priests and sacrifices prefigured Jesus Christ, the perfect priest, and the perfect sacrifice. And flaws in either would mar the picture of the Son of God that was to be portrayed. Okay. Someone read verses 20 through 23. Do we have more than one mic out there?
Mm-hmm.
No.
What verse?
Oh, okay.
But whatsoever hath a blemish, that shall ye not offer, for it shall not be acceptable for you. And whosoever offereth a sacrifice of peace offerings unto the Lord to accomplish his vow, or free will offering in beeves or sheep, it shall be perfect to be accepted. There shall be no blemish therein. Blind or broken or maimed or having a wind or scurvy or scabbed, ye shall not offer these unto the Lord, nor make an offering by fire of them upon the altar unto the Lord.
23.
Either a bullock or a lamb that hath anything superfluous or lacking in his parts, that mayest thou offer for a freewill offering. Before a vow, it shall not be accepted.
Okay, thank you. Now, what was stated in positive terms in verse 19 is now repeated as a prohibition. But whatsoever hath a blemish, said the Lord, that shall ye not offer, for it shall not be acceptable for you. Even one defect was enough to make the sacrifice unacceptable. This prohibition applied to two kinds of peace offering. The first was to fulfill a vow. Now, vows were voluntary, but once entered into, they were as binding as oaths. For example, is of a Nazarite who dedicated himself to God for a fixed period, and at the conclusion, he fulfilled a prescribed ceremony. This included the offering of a ram as a peace offering. The other offering mentioned was free will, which was purely voluntary, expressing personal devotion to the Lord. And in both kinds of offering, the sacrificial animal was to have what? No defects, okay? Now in verse 22, a number of defects are mentioned. The animal could not be blind or broken or maimed or having a wind or scurvy or scabbed. Of course, blind, we know the animal can't see. Broken implies parts that are fractured. Maimed means cut. And wind refers to a running sore. Scurvy speaks of an itch or a scab. Scabbed speaks of an eruptive disease. Any of these injuries or diseases disqualified an animal for sacrifice. Only one exception to the demand was made, a bullock or a lamb that had anything superfluous or lacking in parts, meaning this condition was something in the natural development of the animal and not due to disease or injury. But it could only be offered as a free will, but not for a vow. Okay, now remember I told you we were going to talk about the priests. Priests also had to be perfect. Let me read Leviticus 21, 16 through 23. You want to find that scripture with me? Leviticus 21. Leviticus 21, 16 through 23. there, say amen.
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 16.
Okay, starting at verse 16. And the Lord said to Moses, tell Aaron that any of his descendants from generation to generation who have any bodily defect may not offer the sacrifices to God. For instance, if a man is blind or lame or has a broken nose or any extra fingers or toes or has a broken foot or a hand or has a humpback or is a dwarf or has a defect in his eye or has pimples or scabby skin or has imperfect testicles, although he is a descendant of Aaron, he is not permitted to offer the fire sacrifices to the Lord because of his physical defect. However, he shall be fed with the food of the priests from the offering sacrificed to God, both from the holy and most holy offerings. But he shall not go in behind the veil, nor come near the altar because of the physical defect. This would defile my sanctuary, for it is Jehovah who sanctifies it. Now, I probably read that once before, or many times before, but I guess I never paid attention to it. Okay, so do you think God was unfairly discriminating against handicapped priests, or handicapped people? What do you think? Well, that's your thinking. Anyone else?
What was your question?
Yep.
Do you think God was unfairly discriminating against the handicapped people when he said they were unqualified to offer sacrifices?
I think he was having mercy on them that they couldn't perform what they should and what he commanded.
Okay.
I think he was being a little prejudiced.
Okay.
Because he's the only perfect man.
Right.
And you know,
okay,
we're not perfect.
Right. Joyce, what do you think it?
I don't think it's a discrimination as we define discrimination, you know, today. But he's a perfect Almighty God, and he certainly has the authority, the right, you know, to make decisions about who is to make the sacrifice and the offerings. But I don't think of it as discrimination at all.
Okay. Anyone else? Now, here's what I found. It says, just as God demanded that no imperfect animals be used for sacrifice, he required that no handicapped priests offer sacrifices. This was not meant as an insult. Rather, it had to do with the fact that the priests must match as closely as possible the perfect God he served. Of course, such perfection was not fully realized until Jesus Christ came. As Levites, the handicapped priests were protected and supported with food from the sacrifices. And you heard that in verse 22. They were not abandoned because they still performed many essential services within the tabernacle. So it's not like they were outcasts. You could still become a priest, but you just couldn't offer sacrifices. Okay?
That's the first I've heard this relating to the people, not
the money. I know. So I told you, I probably read that before and didn't pay attention to it. Right. Okay, let's move on. Any other comments? No comments or questions? Okay.
I have been thinking about why he only used the males. I think he didn't want to use the females because they reproduce. And so that way, you know, they could be half pregnant or something like that.
Okay.
So he used the males, not the females, so they can keep on reproducing the flock.
Okay. All right. Any other thoughts on that?
That's what I found, too.
That's what I found too. At once they accepted females, but they still preferred the male. Yeah, I found that in my reading. So, male won. Okay, they also wanted no castrated animals in verse 24. May I have a reader? Verse 24.
Ye shall not offer unto the Lord that which is bruised or crushed or broken or cut, neither shall you make any offering thereof in your land.
Okay, Israelites were forbidden to offer that which is bruised or crushed or broken or cut, which refers to four methods of castration used by ancient people. That also would be unacceptable in the same way as disease or injury. The phrase, neither shall ye make any offering thereof in your land, may well be a prohibition against castration altogether, because it's a mutilation of God's creation, original creation. Okay, now there were no exceptions for foreigners in verse 25. It says, neither from a stranger's hand shall ye offer the bread of your God of any of these, because their corruption is in them, and blemishes be in them. They shall not be accepted for you. Neither from a stranger's hand shall ye offer the bread, which is the food of your God, of any of these, appears to be a continuation of the thought of verse 24. Even though castration was not practiced in their land, Israelites might have been tempted to offer castrated animals that they bought from foreigners or allow sojourners among them to offer them. They were responsible for whatever they offered. Okay, now there's a principle behind acceptable offerings. May I have a reader for verse 31? And 32a, A would be the first sentence in 32. Verse 31 and the first sentence in 32.
Therefore shall ye keep my commandments and do them. I am the Lord. Neither shall ye profane my holy name.
Okay.
But I
stop there. That's okay. A, that first sentence. Okay, now, what was the reason Israel was to observe these commands? Okay, they were God's children. What?
I said, because he's the Lord.
Okay. All right, any other thoughts? Okay, it was simple, wasn't it? What did God say?
I am the Lord.
I am the Lord. There's no other reason needed. I thought about when I was raising my children. I know I have other parents in here. When I was raising my children, sometimes somebody would ask if they could do something, and I say no, what's the first thing they say?
Why?
Why? Then what does the parent say?
Because I said so.
Well, God said, because I said so. You keep my commands. I'm the Father. So we need to remember who God is. Who is the Lord? Who is the Lord?
God Almighty.
Okay. Come on, who else?
The creator of everything.
All right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He's our Father.
The yeah. Father.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Our Father.
He's holy,
yeah.
Compassionate. Mm-hmm. What else?
Hmm?
Loving.
Forgiving.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Don't forget perfect.
Perfect.
Right. And he said to break my commandments is to do what? Profane my holy name. Mm. And it questions his goodness when you profane his holy name. Okay. Now the Lord wants to sanctify Israel. So let's read 32b and 33. But I will be hallowed among the children of Israel. I am the Lord which hallow you, that brought you out of the land of Egypt to be your God. And again, what does he say?
I am the Lord.
I am the Lord. Okay, the Lord designed each law to set Israel apart from all other nations and call attention to his holiness. Do I have a reader for Deuteronomy 7 and 6? Did somebody get that scripture? You have it? Okay.
Okay, Deuteronomy 7 and verse 6. For you are a people holy to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you out of all the peoples on the face of the earth to be his people, his treasured possession.
Okay, now how did Israel deserve to be chosen above all other nations at that time? We talked a little bit about that earlier. What did we say? God's grace. Okay. God's choice of Israel demonstrated not only his holiness, but also his grace. Remember we talked about he redeemed them from slavery, bringing them out of Egypt and with keeping his promise to their ancestors. He was now their God, and they were a uniquely privileged people. And Moses reminded them before he died. He reminded them to obey the Lord's statutes, which showed gratitude for his grace. Okay, that concludes my lesson. I just have to do the closing. I'd like some comments or questions. If you have questions, we have to go get Pastor John Jackson. Okay. Okay. You might have to see me after.
And while you're looking for that, I'm reading down further where you just finished in Deuteronomy, and it says, the Lord did not set his affection on you and choose you because you were more numerous than other peoples, for you were the fewest of all people. But it was because the Lord loved you and kept the oath he swore to your ancestors, that he brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the land of slavery, from the power of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know therefore that the Lord your God is God. He is the faithful God, keeping his covenant of love to 1,000 generations of those who love him and keep his commandments. And then he goes on and on. So he tells there why he chose them.
Okay. Shirley, you still want to hear what I have? Yeah. Go ahead, Karen.
Something that I did mention when we were in Bible study, that when we do the Lord's Prayer, the word hallow, so many times I hear people say, hallowed be thy name. Hallow means empty. So we have to be very careful when we say, sing, the Lord's Prayer, that we pronounce hallow instead of saying hollow.
Right. Two different words. Two different meanings. Yep. Okay, to your question, Shirley, Ms. Moorhead. I read that God had a reason for rescuing the Israelites from slavery. Now, this is what I found. You know, nobody knows the real reason, but this is, you know, from research. Now he was ready to tell them what it was. Israel was to become a kingdom of priests and a holy nation where anyone could approach God freely. It didn't take long, however, for the people to corrupt God's plan. God then established Aaron's descendants from the tribe of Levi as priests, representing what the entire nation should have been. But with the coming of Jesus Christ, God has once again extended his plan to all believers. The death and resurrection of Christ has allowed each of us to approach God freely. So it seems that he wanted them to be a nation of priests. Yeah, that's what the research that I found was saying. And after that didn't work, you know, he had to go through the tribe of Levi to get the priests. And of course, the only high priest is Jesus Christ. Yeah. Hopefully they help you. Okay. Okay, other comments or questions? All right, let's go to our closing. Christians today are not required to bring animal offerings to the Lord to express our fellowship with Him. Aren't you glad about that? Can you see yourself trying to sacrifice an animal, trying to kill an animal, and put him on the altar? Jesus, the perfect sacrifice, purchased our fellowship with God and made peace through the blood of the cross. So what's left for us to do? Okay, number one is to show our gratitude through the living sacrifice of ourselves, as in Romans 12 and 1. What does Paul tell us? Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual worship. Number two, the sacrifice of verbal praise, as in Hebrews 13 and 15. Through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that confess his name. And number three, the sacrifice of good deeds and sharing. Hebrews 13 and 16 that says, and do not forget to do good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices, God is pleased. In our offerings, we should be guided by the same principles that was given to Israel, to give the Lord what? The best we have. When we give the sacrifice God planned for us out of gratitude, humility, and kindness, we step into a place of blessing. God is not forgetful of those who honor him. And Luke 6 and 38, I put this in my lesson, and then I looked in the bulletin today, and that's Pastor Jackson's text. Luke 6 and 38. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Thank you so much for your participation. Next Sunday's lesson, Obedience in Feasts, is found in Leviticus chapter 23, verses 33 through 43. Okay, that concludes my lesson. Yes. Okay. All right, let's have a closing prayer. We'll do a quick prayer. Lord, we thank you for leading us through this lesson. And Lord, hopefully we are striving to understand your word so that we can live it in our daily lives. We ask you to bless our worship service today. Bless the preacher of the word and bless the word. In Jesus' name, amen.
And we want to thank Sister Bradley for doing a beautiful job this week.